We will move on to the next item on the agenda, which is a discussion of the superintendent search and selection of a new superintendent. Before we have, I guess the first thing is for the school committee members, do I hear a motion to proceed with a discussion related to superintendency and appointment of a superintendent of schools?
I move.
Second.
Ms. Ball moves and Ms. Scoville seconds. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, I hear Mr. Brasco, Ms. Scoville, Mr. Morrison, and I am also an aye. So that motion passes 4-0-0. Anne just texted me to say that she says aye as well. I will take a look for her again to see if I can find her on here. I'm sorry, that motion passes 5-0-0. So before we have a discussion about the finalists, we need to discuss how many votes do we want to have a majority vote, which would be 3 out of 5 votes in order to select a superintendent, or do we want to have a supermajority, which I think would be 4 votes? School committee members, anybody like?
I would prefer a supermajority of 4 votes to proceed with the nomination.
Okay.
That's fine. I concur.
Okay, so we'll have a supermajority of 4 votes. Okay. So then the chair declares that the appointment of superintendent will require 4 affirmative votes cast for any candidate. For the process this afternoon, I first wanted to just review. So we're going to have a high level review of the process that we've gone through to date, a high level review of the references that were done on the candidates. The school committee members will share the reflections on each candidate. And then we will have a straw poll to start the process of trying to select a candidate. So just as a review of the process of what's happened after the screening and interview committee recommended finalists, each of the finalists who were selected visited Bedford to meet with the district leadership and have the conversation on Bedford TV in lieu of regular site visit and meeting. That conversation used questions that were submitted by student families, community members, faculty, and staff. We surveyed students, families, community, faculty, and staff about the candidates. We received 194 responses as of last night, or approximately 50 to 60 per finalist. Thank you to those of you who did submit a survey response. It was very helpful, at least to me, in terms of looking at the candidates through a different lens than I may have otherwise. The other school committee members and I did reference checks with current and former superintendents, school committee chairs, colleagues, mentors, and others. And then in lieu of doing a site visit to the districts where the finalists are currently working, I had telephone conversations with teachers, administrators, students, and parents in each district. So the next item is a review of the references. Mr. Brasco, do you want to share the high-level information that you received in the references and who you spoke with?
Sure. I spoke with, of the official references, I believe I spoke with 3. I spoke with Nan Murphy's references, including Ann Ludes, who's the Assistant Superintendent of Secondary Education in Framingham. I spoke with Jennifer Stiss, who's the Director of Student Services in Reading. When I spoke to them, certainly validated Nan's incredible capability of looking at data and working with groups of faculty and administrators on improving subgroup scores and test scores with great effectiveness. I asked specific questions about her work with various ages of students, including middle school and high school students, as we had wondered about, and got some feedback about that. Her self-reflection on being an incredible collaborator and partner in the turnaround process with schools was validated by the references. They're both very, very complimentary of her work in those areas. I spoke with the chair of the Weston School Committee regarding Anthony Parker, who gave a very positive reference and referred back to what Mr. Parker spoke about with us, particularly the June Academy and some of the schedule changes that he led and pushed through with partnership from various constituencies, and was very complimentary of Mr. Parker's work in those areas as well.
Great, thank you. Brett Morrison, do you have reflections that you wanted to share in the interview? I'm sorry, on the references that you checked?
Yes, I spoke with one reference for Anthony Parker, Dr. James Marini, who was a former mentor and colleague in Newton and a superintendent, but was not the superintendent for Anthony Parker. He gave a very, very strong reference referring to Anthony Parker's collegial abilities to build community, his absolutely compelling concern for children and the really powerful values that he holds and is able to establish wonderful rapport with his leadership teams through that value system and his strong belief in interpersonal relations. So that's the only reference that I was able to check.
Okay, thank you. So I also spoke with one reference for Mr. Parker, that is his current superintendent, as well as speaking with teachers, the assistant superintendent, K to 12 and 6 to 12 administrators and parents of high school students in Weston. Overall, they were all very positive. He was described generally by pretty much everybody as a really nice person, very compassionate and caring about students and faculty, collaborative and a good listener. Some of the quotes that I have from things that references said about him, he's a very effective system of distributive leadership. He is excellent at taking care of staff. One of the references said that Mr. Parker is able to deploy resources to help teachers who are having challenges. A direct quote, Mr. Parker gives immediate feedback that feels supportive. He's quite a good collaborator. Another person said he makes staff feel able to take risks. He empowers department heads and directors, gives them a lot of influence to do their jobs. He's very approachable. Mr. Parker has worked on a strategic plan for his school. He has, so Weston is going through a process right now of making some budget cuts, and one of his references said that he really has chosen the option that is least impactful on students where he's had to make cuts. A direct quote, he's done a great job making cuts that really maintain programming. He cares about kids who are sort of in the middle. I also checked references for Phil Conrad. I spoke with several of the superintendents that he's worked with and assistant superintendents, both in Andover and in Hamilton-Wenham. I spoke with a school committee member, one of his mentors, members of his faculty, staff, and leadership at Andover High School, and several students and a parent. He was described generally as very honest, sincere, collaborative, approachable, compassionate, and student-focused. A direct quote, Mr. Conrad builds relationships first so that work can get done. A person who directly supervised him told me that he has experience with union relations. Several people told me that Mr. Conrad was hired as principal after time of transition, where there were several principals who were at the high school for a short period of time. The person said Mr. Conrad was successfully building the trust of staff and faculty. Several people told me about a difficult human resource matter that Mr. Conrad handled. Direct quote, he put students first, even if it wasn't what the community liked. He made the decision independently in the face of public opposition from students and parents, and persuaded a number of people to change their view. One of the references told me that Mr. Conrad had hired most of the assistant principals who are there now and built a strong team and a good faculty at the high school. And what he doesn't have experience in, he'll know who to reach out to ask for to partner and bring a positive outcome. Two people told me that Mr. Conrad has worked on developing the strategic plans in different districts where he has worked. And he makes his recommendations based upon data. In talking about the budget, several people told me that he's managed a high school budget. He understands it within the context of the district budget. He was able to identify what was needed, why it was important, and its impact on students. One person with direct knowledge of Mr. Conrad's work on the budget said he did a great job with the high school budget. He's allocated money for, this is a direct quote. He's allocated money for students potentially at risk for virtual learning. He uses the budget to move the school forward, making strategic investments. That's how you create change, not 1,000 initiatives. He's very focused about it. When he was in Hamilton Wenham, Mr. Conrad was the spokesperson for an override vote on behalf of the schools in town. A reference who supervised him said, Phil really believes it's important to nurture a good intellectual environment, but also to provide social and emotional guardrails. The school's role is to initiate and grow and ensure students have the experience that they've dreamt of. His greatest strength is managing a diverse student body and active parents. He deals with student discipline in a compassionate way and tries to turn it into a learning experience. He has good follow-up. When Mr. Conrad started at Andover High School, they were in the middle of a planned change in the school schedule that reduced the number of classes per day. There were a number of parents who were concerned that the new schedule gave students only 7 opportunities instead of 8 to take advanced placement courses. He was able to help the parents understand that that change may have reduced the access to advanced placement courses, but it did offer an important opportunity to build relationships between students and teachers. I also spoke with I have a whole bunch of pile of papers next to my computer. I also did a reference check for Nan Murphy with a former superintendent, and also spoke with a number of her colleagues when she was in Lowell, as well as other staff members and a parent. They said that she was firm but fair, took their concerns seriously, made decisions based on evidence. She listens well and considers others' opinions. Her school was top tier. Direct quote, it was just outstanding. It was used by the district as a model with respect to equity. The state also used it as an example of a turnaround school and referred other principals and superintendents to her. She's very personable to staff. There were several people who shared anecdotes about her encouraging them as they were teachers at her school to stretch and reach for larger roles. At times when she has had potential disagreements with colleagues and staff, she's handled the situation well. She's able to bring them into the fold as collaborators. She did have direct experience with budgeting for her school. She sought and managed grants directly in partnership with a state team that was providing oversight. While she was in the central office, she worked on the overall budget of $200 million for Lowell Public Schools in the same way as an assistant superintendent would. She's very academic and likes evidence and proof. So those were just a few of the comments from the people that I spoke with. What I'd like to do now is ask each of the school committee members to to share the reflections. And before we do that, I'm just going to see, Ann said she's on here now, so I'm going to try and find her and unmute her, if you can have a moment of patience with me. Let's see. Ann, I am still not seeing you.
Oh, now she's under.
Oh, there she
I
is.
I see okay. Under Ann Quay now. Yeah.
She has her name, yes.
Ann, are you on?
I am on.
Oh, oh hi,
yay.
Ann.
I'm so glad. Terrific.
Your error, I'll just leave it at that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. What I'd like to do now is have each of the school committee members share their reflections on the three finalists that we're considering. Anybody want to volunteer to start? Or do we want to just go down as if we were sitting at the table?
Let's go down as if we were sitting. I just have a question. Okay. Do you want these comments and then how we're feeling about who we like, or do you want to save that for later?
So I think I'd like to do reflections and then we can have a straw poll. Would that work?
Yes.
It could. I mean, because I could present my reflections so that you'll know what I'm going to say in my straw poll, or I could present my reflections without indicating where I'm leaning. What would you prefer?
I think we're an open meeting and you're welcome to share whatever you think is appropriate.
Sure. Okay. So,
I'm sorry. I have a question from Mara. And I'm not sure if I think she needs us to identify who's speaking. So as you go through, just state your name.
All right. Sure.
And before we start the process, can I just ask, is there a sequence we're agreeing on with regard to speaking about the three candidates, or does that not matter?
I don't think it matters. Okay. If you'd like an order, we could go alphabetically by surname.
Let's do that.
Okay. All right. So that would be Mr. Conrad, Ms. Murphy, and then Mr. Parker.
All right, would you like me to go first?
Sure, please.
All right, so Mr. Conrad. So I'll just say, I got to meet each of these folks twice. I was in the initial screening committee, and so I had one interview with them, and two, so I've seen both of these, all three of these finalists for 3 hours total, which is great. Regarding Mr. Conrad, I liked a lot of what Mr. Conrad said. I thought he had some very innovative ideas. When we asked the finalists about how they would hire and what kind of questions they would ask, mm-hmm. he was in fact the only finalist that had specific examples, and I thought they were all excellent questions that he referred mm-hmm. to. Mm-hmm. I thought he had great reflections on how to use data regarding student achievement and test scores. I really appreciated his answer about co-teaching.
Mm-hmm.
He acknowledged that in high achieving districts, there was this tendency to have high achievers who are stagnating and not moving along, and how mm-hmm. he was beginning to address that in Andover, and I'd be excited to see how he would address that in Bedford. I really enjoyed and found him quite credible when he spoke about equity. I think he gave an outstanding answer to how he utilized not just local, but state and even federal resources and legislators in the work that he did, which was very sophisticated and really, I think, set him apart from the other finalists.
Mm-hmm.
I thought he was very comfortable and very relatable. He spoke almost flawlessly when it came to pacing and correcting himself and finding words. It was really a command of the language and the interview, which I really felt was also different than the other finalists. He spoke efficiently. He spoke with brevity when appropriate, and I appreciated that. The things I did not think were very good from the final, which is just, I mean, not as excellent. I thought he did not know a lot about the Hanscom funding, which I thought maybe he would. And I don't think he handled the question about the relationship between the school committee members and the superintendent very well. Mm-hmm. But I was very impressed with Mr. Conrad. With Mr. Parker, as we've heard, I thought it was very credible and interesting, and I found it believable when he talked about his tending to relationships and his connection with people. I really appreciated how he would connect with each listener in the room, not just school committee members, but the secretary and the superintendent and the assistant superintendent, the director of finance, and the Bedford TV folks really took care to take time to meet and know and speak to everybody and linger so that you could watch him as he was talking, which was very unique and different. I really appreciated and respected his reflections on innovation, particularly in June Academy, and the way he asked us to wonder, like, what if and what could we do together with somebody like him in charge. I found incredible when he spoke about hiring a diverse faculty. In fact, he has, and that was also important and a demonstrated thing that we were thinking about strategically. I certainly believe he puts kids first in every decision, which I think is really important. I think he gave a lot of credit to others when he was answering. I really appreciate when folks distribute credit and validation to other people they work with when they're answering questions, and he did that many, many times. And he gave a very unique answer when we asked him about restorative justice and working with SROs, and really framed it in a way which I found very interesting and different and incredible. I do not think he addressed the role of the school committee and superintendent well. I actually do think there's a correct answer to that question, and we did not get it from him. I do not think it is our role to support the superintendent first. I think our roles are very clearly articulated, and that is to supervise the superintendent, to set the budget and to review policy. So I was curious as to why that answer was given. And I also felt like of all the finalists, he did not know the most about Bedford. And in between the first time I spoke to him, the second time I spoke to him, did not seem like he'd learned more about the district. And regarding Nan Murphy, I found her extremely credible in a lot of really important areas. I found her very credible in reflecting on co-teaching and inclusion. I found her very credible in talking about subgroup test scores and turning around low achieving students. She certainly understands that in a way which is very sophisticated and different than probably the other two finalists. I really appreciated her answer when she said that all means all. And when she talked about being number one for some when it came to public education in the Commonwealth. And I also appreciated her perspective as a military spouse and her reflection on how the Hanscom population presents a different kind of challenge and opportunity for Bedford. My concerns with Nan were her limited middle school and high school experience. And did not also address the question about superintendent and school committee relationships in a way which I thought was really, really credible, and did not reflect on or demonstrate responsibility beyond a very specific local level in Lowell. Those are my reflections on the three. I am a strong, strong proponent of Phil Conrad, and that's where I'm leaning right now.
Thank you. Brad?
First of all, I would like to say thank you to Joanne and Dan and all of the other members of the committee that brought forward these candidates, including the parents and teachers and administrators who served on that committee. You've done a tremendous amount of work, and we're blessed now with three really strong candidates. I think that that it was really fabulous, and to the entire public of Bedford, really great to get so much input, and likewise from the staff and teachers in the Bedford Public School System. So I feel very good about the process that's brought us to this point, and I want to thank everybody for their roles in making that happen. I guess since Dan started that way, I will just start by saying I too am a very strong proponent of Phil Conrad, and I'll comment on all three candidates. One of the things that I particularly liked about Phil's opening comments was that he acknowledged that he's coming from a very traditional path to superintendent, having been a teacher and a department head, an assistant principal and a principal and then a principal at a bigger school and so on. And that just made me feel like the step to superintendent is an appropriate one for him now. Mm-hmm. And I really, really loved that he called out from the very beginning, I mean, literally 30 seconds into the interview, the importance of the social emotional component of what we do in the school systems and mental health. And I think he spoke credibly about that theme at the beginning, throughout, and at the end. And I think that that is a crucial issue. And I can tell that it's very, very important to him. I I enjoy the idea that he's coming from a school, a high school that has a scale kind of similar to our district as a whole. So I feel confident that he has the experience that prepares him to take on this job. Like all three of our candidates, he has not previously served as a superintendent. So there's obviously a need for some learning and growth there, but I felt confident that he would be able to do that. I was particularly pleased that I often heard him speak about the need for balance. That was a word that he used frequently and fluently, I think. And I do think that much of what the job of the superintendent is finding ways to balance conflicting needs, demands, challenges, and so on. And I enjoyed the way he said that he would work to seek trust from the community. I could clearly tell that he valued the importance of relationships, and not just within the school system itself, but also throughout the community, and that's quite important. I liked his view on data, the use of data, and by his view, I mean the sort of limited value of data, that's not coming out the right way, that there is a limit to how much one can stretch the use of data, and that it's only one piece in a larger puzzle. And I think he put that in very very good stark relief with the importance of data and the importance of making sure we interpret things really well. I enjoy that he talked about one of his innovations in Andover, which is Kaleidoscope. And he also talked about not forcing that on Bedford. So it wasn't as though he was coming in with an agenda to do that, but he was quite responsive to the need for innovation and so on. And I guess more than anything, what came through quite powerfully for me was that he is a man with a very strong value system, values that I think we would all be able to relate to. And it was quite clear to me how this relates to a comment that Mr. Scheinfeld made during the public commentary, that I could easily imagine how his values would translate to the front lines for teachers and kids throughout the system. And I think that's a really, really strong leadership capability that would serve us exceptionally well. So let me move on to, I'm going to go in the alphabetical order that we suggested. So let me move to Nan. That's all right. we're going to go with Nan Murphy next. I really appreciated that she was a lifelong educator and was proud of that. I think she spoke very eloquently about being the spouse of a Marine and having been brought up through a military upbringing. And that certainly serves us well here in Bedford, especially with the need to understand the unique circumstances of people from our Hanscom community. And it was quite clear to me that she is exceptionally passionate about what she does. I wrote down the words, "I love what I do," and that part of her motivation for applying for this position and coming to Bedford is, in her words, that she misses being connected to the work. And so I think she wants to get more connected to teachers and children. And that's just an absolutely wonderful characteristic that we really want to enjoy. Another thing that I connected to quite a bit was something that Dan already mentioned, her sensibility about the importance of getting to all children. And I wrote down the same words that Dan had said before. The way she talked about being number one for some is not the same as being number one for all was just absolutely exceptional. And I think it is truly a high priority for Bedford. So I really appreciated her saying that. And finally, what I'd say about Nan is that I thought her closing remarks were, if I can use a sports metaphor, an absolute home run. She said that she had referred to our survey to find out what Bedford wanted for their in their superintendent, and she listed the five top items, which were excellent communication, understanding and recognizing what good teaching is, proven experience for improving academic achievement, experience in curricular development and experience in working with a diverse population. And I was delighted to hear her recognize those. And I also just interpreted that as a signal that she was well prepared. She did her homework. And of course, that's good in interviewing practice, but it speaks to me as relevant for a superintendent who is often going to have to be messaging things to our community. And I appreciated that she prepared herself, was able to do that eloquently, and I thought it was just an absolute strength. Really, really well done. With regard to Mr. Parker, I concur with everything that that Dan said. His absolute pervasive first priority interest, keeping the kids first, comes through in everything that he does. I really appreciated the way he started off by saying that what Bedford is a place that will ask, how does an excellent district become more excellent? And I think that that is a very nice capsulization of where we are and the need to continually strive to be more excellent. I really love that. Dan's already mentioned the June Academy. That's very impressive. And it's impressive for what he did, but also a little bit about how he did it. That has got legs now. It's being copied by other school systems. It has these wonderful features, like students are actually involved in co-teaching. And the thing that I wanted to add to what was, I thought, so impressive about that was he didn't really do that. He did it by allowing someone else to do it. Mm-hmm. It was someone else's idea. And I'm saying that as an absolute, really powerful strength. He was the person who created an atmosphere in which someone else's innovative idea could thrive, and he nourished it. And now he's cheerleading it and even bragging about it. And that's all a sign of a fabulous environment for people to be working in, and they really like that. The last thing I want to say about Mr. Parker was that I was the host when he visited us. And during some time that we didn't have allocated to do anything else, he asked if he could walk the buildings. And that was a day that the high school was closed down because of the COVID situation, but the JGMS was open. So we walked around the building, and first of all, just that he has to do that, I think really speaks to his sort of personality as a leader. And I watched him interact with a few teachers in the hallways where he was just inquisitive and caring. And I could see that he was valuing their opinions. We walked across the street and saw some kids on the athletic fields and so on. And so, back in the 1980s, there was a phrase called management by wandering around that became kind of famous. And I could see that he's sort of natural at doing that. Mm-hmm. And I just really appreciated how warm and caring an individual he is. And I could certainly see him as a leader that people would be responsive to. So for me, Mr. Conrad rises to the top of an absolutely fabulous pack for the reasons that I stated. And I think I should stop and pass it on to others.
Anne?
Hello. First at the outset, I just want to applaud everyone, particularly the candidates in Bedford TV, for making this interview process possible in these incredibly difficult times. The flexibility, the willingness to work around every conceivable and inconceivable problem. I really want to applaud everyone. And also to say that I'm just so thrilled to see we have three very, very strong finalists with different skill sets. And once again, it's just wonderful to see the talent Bedford attracts. I knew that was the case, but it's always nice to see it in action. Starting with Phil Conrad, I had the opportunity to host him at school and actually conduct his interview for Bedford TV. So we spent a considerable amount of time together. I'll echo many of the remarks of both Dan and Brad, his experience as a middle school and high school principal, his work in different projects that benefit different student groups I really liked, and he genuinely was interested in them, the Kaleidoscope project, a new project launched by the state. Andover is one of 20 towns participating. Also, bringing the Capstone Project to Andover, which is another opportunity for students to shine, and then seeing the support there in the high school and deciding to bring it down to the middle school. I thought that spoke a lot. And we talked at length about the new option of the Seal of Biliteracy for students who are may have spoken another language at home and then come to school and learn English, and how they can be certified when they graduate, and what a success that is. The traditional route to superintendent really jumped out at me, but also the experience of developing a curriculum from K to 12. Did a lot of interesting work with that, and I liked hearing about it. He's also had experience, frankly, working in a budget crunch. He's had to make those difficult cuts that folks have to make when we've seen different turns in the economy. And while that's not easy to do, it's an important skill. He placed an incredible amount of emphasis on social emotional learning. And the fact that while you want to be a high performing district, it's really important to meet the students at their needs. He's a courageous leader. He really went out and got to know the community. And we had a discussion at length about the fact about school rankings. Andover's a high school that at one point was a little bit higher in the Boston Globe, Boston Magazine rankings. And when asked about that, he was very honest. He said, listen, everyone is sensitive to rankings. And he could make those changes to make the ranking go up, but it might not benefit the students. And frankly, people may not like it. And I thought that was very honest. Throughout our discussions, he owned mistakes he'd made and shown how he wished he'd done things differently, but didn't hide behind them or deny them. And I liked going through his process. He's had experience with a co-teaching model, although they've done it a little differently in Andover, with accessing expertise from Landmark around students with dyslexia and other issues in that arena, and how well that worked, folding that into the school. That was an interesting approach. I know Bedford's also done that, so I liked seeing that. He talked a lot about achievement gaps, and not just with subgroups, which is a problem for Andover and our district, but also with even in the high achieving students. He said he noted that Andover, he looked at their data and realized that some of the students did really, really well, but even those students were flat. So that he wanted to help every student become a better learner, even the students who other folks don't necessarily look at. He talked a lot about, again, the strong, he didn't just talk about the strong focus on social emotional, he gave concrete examples of steps he'd taken over the years to try to support students, bringing them back if they've been hospitalized, struggling with issues at school. And he was very open that anyone could do more, but that he was committed to making that happen. I loved his stories about inviting legislators to the schools, to Andover High School specifically. He had the state rep and the state senator spend the day. And as many of us know, school in 2020 doesn't look anything like school in 1980 or 1990 or whenever you went to school. And I thought, what a smart thing to do. It's one thing to go to the state house and ask for resources. It's another to take advantage of that opportunity, bring those folks to school and spend the day with them. It went very, very well. I liked hearing about it. He's also had a good strength on accessing additional resources for the schools, whether that meant going out in the community, but even more importantly at the state and even the federal level, which is not something we need to do all the time, but when it's a good skill to have when those needs come up. And for those folks who may or may not remember, last year Andover had a horrible experience with gas explosions. And because we spent so much time together in the interviewing process, I had a chance to have several discussions about what that experience was like, given what was going on now. And he shared that it was their back to school night and that teachers were out in the community. And he took us through the process of the explosions and then what it was like in real time to try to get help for students, faculty, and other folks in the community impacted. And he wasn't suggesting that he solved for every problem, but that he met people where their needs were. He knew that people were traumatized by what had occurred and sort of how to bring that semblance of normalcy back to school. Even going so far as to cooking meals at the senior center just so they could feed folks. And you don't want to plan around emergencies, but given what's going on now and then that experience, I found it very, very interesting. One thing I forgot to comment with respect to all the candidates, one thing we did this time, the school committee gave folks the questions in advance. So they had an opportunity to see them. And so it's interesting to see where folks did a great job answering questions and maybe missed some other things. I just thought it was important to share that with folks. And finally, he said, so much of what he does is deciding what is best for students. And we'd like to think that always happens, but we have to remind ourselves that. There's a lot of stakeholders looking to create a lot of opportunities and make changes. And he sort of uses that as his guide, and I thought it was helpful. And then we had one question that came up about use of SROs, security resource officers, and restorative justice. And I liked his discussion about what their peer mediation group looked like at school and how impactful that was with students. Again, an example of where that's a learning opportunity. I thought he was a very good candidate. I'll turn next to Nan Murphy. I also hosted her for the day. I loved her experience of both being a military spouse, but also teaching on a military base. Our Hanscom families have a unique experience, and she shared a lot of that. And that's something I always keep an eye out for. And she's also had experience with Tenacity Challenge in Bedford. She's familiar with the needs of Hanscom Air Force Base. Lowell does not have the METCO program. She seems to know it pretty well. So I felt she knew our community well, and that was appealing to me. She is truly committed to inclusion. She made it work working at the McAuliffe School in Lowell. They did it. And she knows how challenging it can be, but she really seemed committed to meeting the needs of the students. And I applaud that work. And frankly, she took us through a very lengthy discussion about what it was like to be assigned to a school that was a three, and not getting necessarily resources from the Commonwealth to improve it, and having all those needs of the subgroups that we see in Bedford, and frankly, taking it to a one without a lot of money. And that's not easy. And I thought she deserved a lot of just a lot of kudos for that. And really working with the staff and sort of going in with the, we can do this, and being committed to the values that the school had and what that looked like. You know, she had a lot of experience. And my takeaway from her interview was, number one, not for some, but for all. And she lived mm-hmm. it with the ELL students, the special ed students, and frankly, poverty is a great issue in Lowell, and making sure those students have those resources. I too thought her closing was outstanding. She had budgets experience. I love that she spent, so she, in addition to being a principal, she worked in central office in Lowell, got that experience in working with on school improvement, and she told the story of how the commissioner and Desi were so impressed with the work she had done at the McAuliffe School to frankly improve the performance of the students. They wanted her to come to the State House. And as she explained it, she said, I'd really rather you come to the school and meet the teachers who accomplished this. I'm part of that success, but I don't explain all of it. And I thought that spoke volumes. I also like the fact that she has experience at Desi at the Department of Education. I think that can be incredibly helpful as we try to navigate all the different mandates and discussions and approaches to education, having that as people. And probably her biggest strength to me was she had success with subgroups. And that's something in Bedford needs. We keep trying and we're doing our best, but she accomplished that. And I think there's something to be learned there. So I really enjoyed meeting with Nan, and I thought she did a great job interviewing. And then finally, the third, going in alphabetical order, is Anthony Parker from Western High. And my takeaway from Anthony's interview, I spent probably the least amount of time with Anthony because I didn't host him and I didn't interview him for Bedford TV, but really got a flavor by listening to other folks and seeing him in the school committee meeting. I just loved how he asked, how does an excellent district become more excellent? I thought it was a really good question coming from Weston. He's had experience both teaching in Newton and then as a principal in Weston. living in those high performing districts, but knowing that not everyone's students, not all students' needs are met. And what does that look like? Balancing the interests of parents who really want to see the schools take off versus what meeting the students at their needs. And I thought he did a really great job with that. I loved the story about the June Academy, Learning to Learn. It's a program that runs after academics end, and it's an opportunity for students to co-teach with faculty on any yoga, whatever you'd like to talk on. It's a pass-fail program. They've had a lot of success with it, and now they're sharing it with other communities. It's something I'd love to see come to Bedford, and I just loved hearing his stories about it. He talked to, you know, his style was to have those hard conversations in private, but be on the same page in public. That can be a challenge, and that's not always my approach, but I appreciated his honesty about how he likes to operate. And he saw the importance of data and just didn't want to look at anecdotes, but learned to balance them, and I thought that was useful. He was quite candid that Weston needs to do more for their subgroups, and they haven't cracked that yet, but they continue to be committed to it and try and tweak it and figure out better ways to reach the students that they're not currently reaching. He himself has taught in a co-taught model, which is obviously a priority of Bedford's. It's something we're really committed to. It takes a lot of training, a lot of work, and I thought it was really interesting to have someone who actually did it and realizing how important it is, the matches and the training. So I enjoyed that. I thought he gave an outstanding response to the vocational question, which was a question I came up with. And really, we don't have a big voc emphasis in the high school. Some students go to Shawshing Tech and really thrive there. But he turned the question around and said he felt all students were missing by not having any exposure to that today. That there was a time where that was more of what school did, and that he thinks it would benefit everybody to bring some of that back. So I really appreciated that. It gave me sort of some food for thought. He has experience at the State House advocating for the METCO program and other programs that he believes in. And what he always emphasized was including the students in that advocacy work, which I think is a tremendous opportunity. It's very easy to go up to the State House and make your case. It's quite a different experience to bring students along to encourage them to tell their story. And I thought that was great. And then one of the questions we asked about was restorative justice. And what does that look like? And how do you balance that out with resource officers? And he went on at length about the unique relationship they have with their SROs in Weston. The SRO is a former teacher and now is very involved with the community, meets with the parents, really, really is part of the team, much like we have here in Bedford. I liked it. And then he talked in hard facts about restorative justice and the role that can play in helping in challenges that arrive in high school. It's not the answer to everything, but there are situations where it's a learning experience for everyone. And I loved how he pointed to the data of the success by emphasizing that they had seen a drop in suspension rates as a result of that. And I thought that was a good result. So I thought he also was a strong candidate. That's the conclusion of my remarks at this point. So. I'm anxious to hear what Sarah has to say.
Should I go ahead?
Sure.
Great. This is Sarah Scoville. I'll start again with Philip Conrad. I really liked that his district has taken the risk to become part of the pilot program for the Kaleidoscope program, which delves into a program that emphasizes deeper learning, which I feel like is super important. Their priority of capstone projects for several of their grades, which is hands-on project-based learning and really being able to focus on a bigger project. I liked his ideas of data and getting the full picture for a student. He mentioned a panorama survey that I'm intrigued by that. I also, again, the co-teaching model. He talked about the idea of having a classroom marriage being really important, which I thought was a very good analogy and very important. he started as an art teacher, which was a huge bonus for me, of course. I actually thought in the middle of the night the other night, I realized that my uncle, who was a middle school art teacher at Hamilton Wenham, would have overlapped with him. So I called up my uncle, and he highly recommends Phil Conrad, just another side reference, which was really great to get that perspective too. He understands the finances and money. He balances everyone needs and understanding a budget. He understands the state level. He's been on several committees at the state level for advocacy. Again, what Anne was talking about, I really like the legislative shadow program that he talked about. And the priority that he had on building relationships, that was key. All of them talked about how we're in the business of people, and building relationships was fundamental to that. I'm gonna go quick. I agree, since I'm the fourth in line, I agree with all my colleagues. So I'm just gonna do the highlights here of what I picked out. Nan Murphy, again, she talked a lot about deeper learning. She also mentioned the Kaleidoscope program that she, I think, was part of perhaps developing at the DESE level, on the state level. Again, all means all, meaning every kid needs to be reached. Every kid can learn. It's just how to meet their needs. It was her priority. I actually liked the focus that she had, the focus on the younger children and had her experience in the elementary world. We're always talking about what we need to start from K to 12. We have to have the linear K to 12. So I'm glad she had that perspective. I liked how she had articulated early on that she wanted to commit to a district and stay there, which is important when you develop a relationship with a superintendent. The finance part, working with very few resources in Lowell was impressive to do what she did and her elementary program. And then understanding the advocacy at the state level, understanding that perspective. I also liked her idea about community, developing community and being visible in the classrooms and really visiting different classrooms. And then for Anthony Parker, I think we've been throwing out June Academy. I want to say one sentence about what it is. It's several weeks at the end of the year after the seniors have graduated. It's 2 weeks where the teachers can teach what they're super passionate about. Students can learn about what they're passionate about. They can do 2 weeks on one subject or 2 different weeks on 2 different subjects. It's a really innovative, great program that he was very excited about, and I think is a great idea for many districts. His co-teaching, as Anne was saying, was a priority, which was great. And his he did a lot of work with pushing back the start time in the high school. And his priority on EdCamp is one thing that we do with our faculty, is have faculty teach each other what they're passionate and expertise on, which he also is a fan of and facilitates at his school district. He's great at looking at budget needs and what is the greatest need, and really looking at the big picture and not being just focused on what he needs money for at his level. And again, Anne just mentioned it, but the advocacy at the METCO, with METCO at the state level, was impressive. Really trying to listen to the families and the visibility in the community I was impressed with. So once again, thank you for everybody who helped out with this process, and on to your perspective, Joanne.
Okay, thank you very much. So I'm going to start this. I'm going to try not to repeat some of the great points that my school committee colleagues have made. One of the things that I really took away from private discussions with some of the faculty and staff, as well as information that was shared in the online survey by some of the staff is that it can seem like a big jump to go from principal to superintendent. A lot of people who come in as superintendents for the first time have had some experience at the district level. So that was one of the frames that I had looked at this with, looked at the candidates with, among others that my colleagues have shared. So starting with Phil Conrad, he has experience in what, in my limited experience, are some of the key tasks that a superintendent is responsible for. He has worked on strategic plans in several districts. The superintendents that he's worked under said that he sees the budget in the context of the district. So he is looking at more than just the school that he oversees. He has advocated in the community for a significant project for on behalf of the schools, the Hamilton Wenham override vote. So he seems to have some of the administrative capabilities that a superintendent would need. In addition, he's very student focused, which is incredibly important. And then the other, he faced a number of public, some of them very public controversies in Andover while he was there. Some more public than others. And the people that I interviewed, and they aren't all people that he referred me to. Some of them are people that I proactively went to and seemed to feel like he handled it well on behalf of the district, and the superintendent is the public face of the district. And so I think that that's an important skill to have. The other piece that I looked at with Mr. Conrad is, you know, Bedford Public Schools really benefits from the collegial atmosphere among the staff, the town, the school committee. And one thing that really stuck out to me in all of the interviews that I did with people who have supervised or worked with Phil Conrad is that he is really skilled at being able to build relationships, and they help that's something that I think would be very beneficial to help continue the collegial atmosphere in Bedford. Our teachers are our biggest asset, and I would have kept an eye on how I think that the finalists might work with the teachers as I've been considering the candidates. And I also like to focus on social emotional learning. For Nan Murphy, in her initial interview, her insight into the budget was really striking. It really stood out from the rest of the people that we interviewed. She really had some interesting insights into the Bedford budget based upon just what was publicly available to her. She has very strong analytical skills. She oversaw a significant budget when she was working in Lowell. She has a proven track record of getting successfully applying and securing grant funding. She does have district level experience. Her former superintendent described her position once she moved to the district level as analogous to an assistant superintendent. It did give her experience with a large budget. I really loved her experience as, I'm going to repeat here, I loved her experience as a base teacher and a military spouse. Having grown up in a base town with base kids, some of whom are still my friends, I think that that's important. It is It's a different perspective, and I think that would be a great asset. I love the fact that she mentored the people who worked for her and encouraged them to stretch so that some of them moved on to from teacher to leadership. Some of them moved from to district level positions in other towns. And I think that that's also really important. She has a lot of experience managing people. And then for Mr. Parker, I'm sorry if my paper is making too many rustling noises here. He was really excellent at taking care of staff. I heard that from a number of people, not just, so in a professional setting where he was able to be supportive of teachers who were facing professional challenges and making them feel good and helping them to move forward in good collaborator. I actually spoke with the people who came up with the idea for June Academy, so I knew who they were, and I was really impressed that he did share that. One of them who I spoke with after his interview with the school committee did tell me, she said, you know, we really just had the idea. He's the one who ran with it. But I still thought it was important that he had shared that. But he also is personally supportive when he has had staff members who have had personal challenges, that he checks in with them, that he tries to be flexible in within the bounds of what he's able to do in the school. I really liked his vision. He really had a big picture view and vision to look beyond what is. And a number of those have been shared. Another one that none of the school committee members spoke about was the way that moving away from a weighted GPA, which with the goal of allowing students to succeed in a different way and maybe provide more balance because there's not extra weight given to certain types of academic classes. So it may allow students to maintain their GPA while taking classes that are a little bit different and maybe a little bit of a stretch for them more than just academically. And again, the program to introduce careers. I really liked that what I heard from some people was that he thinks about making sure that the top performers are challenged and that students who are at a disadvantage have the resources they need, but he also thinks about the middle of the road kid. I liked the fact that he has had experience not only looking at how to spend money, but how to how cuts are made and thinking carefully about the impact on the students. I think that's it. So do we want to do a straw poll?
Yep.
Okay. Mr. Boskall says yes. Okay. So do you want to start, Dana? We'll move down just like we're at the table.
I'm for Phil.
Okay. Brad?
Yep, I'm for Phil Conrad.
Okay. Ann?
Phil Conrad.
Okay. Sarah?
Phil Conrad.
Okay. And I am also so I'd like to proceed to determine the method of election for we'll now proceed to the election of a superintendent. I'd like to do a ballot method unless anybody has another suggestion.
That's fine.
Okay. So The chair will call the roll, and each member will announce the name of the candidate of his or her choice. At the end of the ballot, I'll announce the vote and ask if all members have voted or if any member wishes to change his or her vote. I will then declare the ballot closed and announce the vote. Mr. Baskall?
Philip Conrad.
Okay. Sorry, my pen's not working. okay. And Mr. Morrison?
Phil Conrad.
Okay. Ms. Gray?
Phil Conrad.
Okay. Ms. Scoville?
Philip Conrad.
Okay. And I also support Philip Conrad. So is there anybody who wishes to change their vote?
No.
No. Okay. So the vote is 5 votes for Philip Conrad. And I declare he's elected. I'd like to ask for a motion to appoint Philip Conrad as superintendent of schools for Bedford effective July 1st, 2020, subject to that. Sorry, I have to turn the page. The successful negotiation of a contract of employment mutually agreeable to the candidate and to the Bedford School Committee and signed by both parties or their designees.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Mr. Morrison moves, and I'm sorry, who seconded?
Sarah.
Okay, and Sarah Scoville seconds. So we need to have a roll call vote. I think I need to have a roll call vote. Let's see.
Might as well.
Okay. All right, let's do it. Let's have a roll call vote. Mr. Baskall?
Yes.
Mr. Morrison?
Yes.
Ms. Gray?
Yes.
Ms. Scoville?
Yes.
And I'm a yes. So the motion passes 500. And before I conclude the meeting, school committee members, do you have anything else that you would like to share?
Yes, if you don't mind, Joanne, I would just like sure. to say thank you to you for your leadership through this process. It has been a long and very successful one, in my opinion. We're not quite finished. We have to actually seal the deal, so to speak. So, yes. But thank you for your leadership.
Thank you. That's very kind. I hope that you all indulge me. There are a lot of people who really helped to make this happen. So I'd just like to go through the list, and if the school committee members would like to add anyone, please feel free. But I'd like to thank each of the applicants and each of the finalists for their interest in Bedford and for working with us on this process. I'd like to thank Glenn Kucher of the Massachusetts Association of School Committees, who has provided a lot of guidance that I've really appreciated. The members of the screening and interview committee who put in a lot of time for the process, Erin Crowley, the superintendent's executive assistant, for her help in setting up a lot of meetings and posting agendas and other things. Katie, Matt, and Mike of Bedford TV for their help in making the process transparent to the community in the face of constant uncertainty in the current public health situation. Julie Turner for her assistance with the community meetings, and the writers for the Bedford Citizen for making sure the community was aware of the process and how they could participate. The faculty, staff, students, families, and community members who provided their input and assistance throughout the process, including the more than 90 who have been on the call today. John Sills for his leadership over the years that he's been in Bedford, and for his support and his assistance with communications, facilitating meetings with staff, and the private guidance that he provided to me. Each of the school committee members for your work throughout the process. Thank you all. I really appreciate the help. We couldn't have done it without each and every one of you and your help. Congratulations.
I have a question, Joanne.
Yes, please.
Could you describe the process now when we're going to, I know that he's a finalist somewhere else. So what is
yes.
the scenario we're looking at right now for everybody?
Okay. So what will happen is at the conclusion of the meeting, I will contact Mr. Conrad and let him know he's been selected as finalist. Assuming he accepts the role, then I will begin working with the school committee attorney and Mr. Conrad to negotiate a contract. And we will send out, a press release through the Bedford Citizen and notify families.
Excellent.
Okay. So congratulations to Mr. Conrad. I'm looking forward to working with him. And with that, I will adjourn the meeting at, 5:29.
You have the motion to adjourn the meeting first.
Okay, sorry. Okay, do I hear motion to adjourn the meeting?
Motion to adjourn.
Okay, so we have a motion to adjourn, put forward by Mr. Brosco and seconded resoundingly by Mr. Morrison and I think everybody else. So we're going to adjourn the meeting at 5:29, not to reopen today, with a roll call vote. Mr. Brosco?
Yes.
Mr. Morrison?
Yes.
Ms. Gray?
Yes.
Ms. Scoville?
Yes.
And I'm a yes. Good night, Bedford.
Congratulations, everybody.
Thank you so much.
Congratulations. Thank you, everybody.